At the end of the last video, I told you that there are these cool ways that we've been able to use pressure and fluids in order to, manipulate the world in ways that benefit us. One of those kind of interesting tools is called Pascal's Law. And it's really neat, almost magical, and I'm going to share it with you right now. Okay? So I want to imagine that we have some sort of situation where we have a little, kind of cylinder here, right? And then a tube that goes out here. And let's make this a little bit, so we want to make this a little bit more broad here. Okay? So you have this situation where it's really kind of broad over here, right? And these are like little movable kind of cylinders or pistons here and over here too. Okay? And we're going to say that on here, we're going to put a Tesla. Okay, this is not a very good Tesla. I've given up. I've given up. And here, this is just basically a button that we can press down. Okay? And here's what we know. Inside here, this is filled with a fluid. Okay? There's all this fluid inside of here. Okay? And if these guys are stable, right? In other words, if this isn't falling down or rising up, and this isn't falling down or rising up here, right? And imagine there's like a little room for this to move, right? There's a move, room for this to move, right? Okay, so if these are stable, that means that the pressure here, we'll call that P1, and the pressure here, P2, they must be the same, right? If these pressures were different, you'd have things like moving up or down, like that. Makes sense, right? So what we know is at this point here and this point here, P1 must equal to P2. Okay? But let's unpack that. What does that mean? That means that the force here at 1, F1, over the area here, remember, pressure is force divided by area, must equal the force applied down here, F2, so this is F1, divided by the area of this guy, which we'll call A2. Okay? So F1 over A1 must equal F2 over A2. All right. So let's go ahead and solve this for F1. So this would mean that F1 equals F2 times A1 all over A2. Okay. That's just a bunch of numbers and letters. But what does it really mean? Okay? So check this out. This means that if we minimize this area, so if we take this area A1 and we make it smaller, okay, while we maximize A2, okay, make A2 as big as possible, right? So this goes down and this goes up. What happens to F1? It's going to go down, like pretty dramatically, right? And so that means that the force required to push down on here to balance, or if you push a little bit harder than that, to actually raise a Tesla, is going to get smaller and smaller if we just reduce this area and make this area bigger. Okay? This is how some hydraulic presses work, right? This is how we're able to use a relatively small force to lift something with an astronomical mass. Okay? So let's put in the numbers, okay? Let's see if we can figure this out. How much force would be required to lift a Tesla, okay, if I put in some random numbers here, let's say if the area of this, or sorry, the radius of this little circle, so we'll say that these little platforms are circular. So if that's a circular platform there that I'm pushing down on, and let's say that it's a half a meter wide, okay, and let's say that this one over here is, I think I used four. Yeah, so let's say that this is 4 meters, okay? All right, if that is the case, with what force would be required to actually lift a Tesla? All right, well, let's put it in. First of all, we need to know the force, okay? The force is basically just the weight of this Tesla, right? Okay, that's the force, the gravitational force pushing down on this platform. So in that case, I have the weight of a Tesla being Well, the mass of a Tesla is roughly 2,000 kilograms. So the weight will be 2,000 kilograms times 9.8.
So this here is going to be 2,000 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second.
Times the area of this platform, right? But if it's circular, the area is going to be pi r squared, right?
But I said that that radius is just 0.5 meters. So I'm going to put 0.5 there. All right,
it's a half a meter radius.
Okay, and I'm saying that this radius here is 4 meters. Okay?
All right. So that would mean that down here, this area is pi r2 squared, but that's 4 meters. So that's pi times 4 squared, right? So really, all I've done here is substitute the weight of the Tesla, which is what's pushing down here, the area of this circular platform here, and then the area of this larger circular platform here, okay? And this is going to give me the force I need to push down then to be able to lift up that Tesla.
And it turns out that I get 306 newtons, which is actually equal to only 68 pounds,
which is nuts, because I weigh more than 68 pounds, which means that if I just stomped right there, I could actually begin to lift a Tesla. Well, more than lift it, because I weigh a little bit more than 68 pounds. So this is a way that we, as scientists, have been able to leverage the characteristics and the qualities of fluids in order to create useful tools that do cool things in the world, like lift really heavy cars, okay? So moving on from there, if you guys could go to the next slide that says absolute versus gauge pressure. This is a subtle distinction, but when we're talking about pressures, sometimes they're represented in subtly different ways, okay? So the absolute pressure is the actual total pressure that's acting on an object objectively in the real world, including atmospheric pressure. So absolute pressure involves how much pressure would I feel, you know, 200 feet under the water, including the atmospheric pressure pushing down on me, plus also the weight of all that water, the pressure involved with all that water pushing down on me, okay? Gauge pressure says, well, here's the thing. On Earth, we know that there's always an atmospheric pressure, so we could really just kind of omit that. So gauge pressure is just the pressure that's in excess of atmospheric pressure. So if I'm in a submarine, I'm underwater, and I look at a little gauge and I'm reading the gauge pressure, that is going to be simply the pressure of my being submerged in that much water without atmospheric pressure being included in there as well. Okay. One common example is that blood pressure readings, you know, for example, 130 over 80, they give the maximum and minimum gauge pressures in the arteries measured in milligrams of mercury or torr. Okay. Blood pressure varies with vertical position of the body, which we're going to talk about later. That's basically goes back to the why do we care question. Okay. So just want to make that distinction. And then when we come back to the next video, we're going to be talking about another one of the most important concepts in fluids, which is buoyancy.